Percussion instruments. Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open
the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. Glory, your glory, pour out your power and love as we sing.
an old hymn of the church. I'll hail the power of Jesus' name. Chosen seed.
Chosen seed of Israel's grace. We ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace. Crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace. And crown him Lord of all.
Crown him Lord. At every kindred. Sing, hail him who saves you by his grace.
Hail him who saves you by his grace. And crown him Lord of all.
Crown him Lord. Light of the world. He made himself poor for you and for me.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you.
So here I am.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether wonderful to me.
He's the King of all days.
King of all days. Oh, so highly exalted. Glorious in heaven above.
He came to earth.
Humbly you came to the earth you created.
And for the sake of love, that's why we're here to worship.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely.
And you are worthy.
And so wonderful.
Wonderful to me. Here I am. Here I am to worship.
As we bow our heads this morning, we will never know how much it costs for our sin to be on that cross. But we pray this morning as we enter a time of confession, Lord, as we just have a moment of silence here, that you help us to reflect on this previous week. Lord, the sins that we know about and those that we do not know about, we pray, God, that we can just have a moment of confession, a time, Lord, of honesty, just between me and you, Lord. Pray, God, that take this moment and have some confession. Lord, please forgive us of those sins, Lord, that we know of and those sins that we do not know. Help us, Lord, to recognize the sin that's in our life and ask those who we've maybe offended this previous week to forgive us, Lord. Pray, God, that we live a life full of grace, meaning that we understand your grace and that we give others grace, knowing that no one here is perfect. We come to you with honesty, with transparency. We pray, God, that you help guide our lives into authentic faith each and every day. Holy and gracious God, please bless, guide, and fashion all the fathers among us today. May their hearts welcome you more fully than ever, and their lives be on a transformation pathway. And Lord Jesus, regarding the message today, the sermon theme on one's true identity and living truly authentic lives, help every one of us present this morning to know that just as a memory helps us immeasurably regarding people, places, daily events, and navigating our lives in practical ways, so also knowing you as both Creator and Savior is our chief aid in coming to know one, our true selves. Identity is more a gift than achievement and more a discovery than one's own creation. We have so much to personally learn from you, Lord, about finding our true selves and then living out that true identity so we won't cheat you or the world. Grant us wisdom, insight, and resolve in these matters. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray this. You may be seated. We're going to continue to pray our congregational prayers, so I'd like you to bow your heads once again as we pray for our congregation. Lord, for medical concerns, we lift up Erica Husing's 1.5-year-old niece, Tegan Grace. For Stephanie Vinskiak's medical challenges, we lift those up to you, Lord. And also, Lord, for those who are recovering from surgery, Doreen Quammen and Jacob Minshaw, Jeannie Effenberger, Lord, we lift these up to you. We pray, God, that there's a quick recovery for those who are recovering from surgery, for those, Lord, who have medical concerns. Lord, we pray, God, that you just create a peace in their lives. Help them, Lord, to be able to live and abide by you, not to feel doomed by their medical condition, but instead to find hope and to find peace in you, Lord. We pray for those who are battling cancer, Jan Furman's sister, Shannon, and also we pray for the family and friends of CTS 11 member Mindy Landis, and for the Berg and Gatewood families and their recent loss of their daughter Sarah, for Dina Winger and family and the recent loss of her mother, Marianne Huffer, for Tracy Clark and family and the recent loss of her grandmother, Sophia, for Donna Bass and family and their recent loss of their sudden loss of their great Aunt Jean. Lord, for Jill Foster's, for her and her family and the recent loss of her mother in South Bend. Lord, we lift those families up to you who have lost family members recently, and as we've our lost friends recently. We pray, God, that you give them strength and courage. Lord, also be with Nell Gordon, who's in hospice care, Jerry Juanilla in hospice care as well, and Jason Legendre's mother, Debbie. We pray that, Jesus, that you'll show her the truth. We also want to lift up families, as we do every week, Lord, for David and Shelley Fleming with Sophia, Michael, and Andrew, for Jonathan Forer, for Kurt and Nancy Foley with Nick, and for John and Shelley Forsman with James and Amy, for Sarah Fortson, for Eldon and Jill Foster with Audrey and Nathan. Lord, we lift these families up to you. May there be a peace in their homes. May they look to you for guidance and wisdom. May you direct even their finances and their everyday decisions, Lord. We lift all those things up to you and pray just a prayer of blessing over each home. In your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. At this time, we have a baptism.
I want to invite right now Sean and Karen to come forward with young Matthew Christopher and also Teresa and David for our baptism. And then have you faced the congregation on this side? So think about it this way, Sean and Karen, you fell in love. Sean left Great Britain and lives here in the States, but he has that obvious, wonderful English accent. And they have a boy a few years old we baptized a few years ago, young Nathan. And Nathan's throne now is a two-seater with Matthew and Christopher. And I know how much your family means to you guys. So if you could take a moment and share with the people here who's here with you and other people who are there and where they're from, would you? Well, welcome all of you. God bless you on this summer Sunday. Welcome to each and all of you. Now listen, you think about Matthew's names, Matthew, Christopher, Matthias. That's very curious because Matthew is one of the original 12 disciples who was a tax collector and wrote the Gospel of Matthew. But Matthias was the Judas replacement. When Judas went headlong into destruction, the 11 prayed and discerned that the one who would succeed and hold that 12th spot in apostleship was the man named Matthias. So you've grouped it well together without even intending to in a beautiful way. But I need to ask you as parents and godparents a couple questions with regard to the Christian faith that I need to hear some responses from you. Do you truly believe that God is your Creator and Heavenly Father, that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, and that God is with you in a very mysterious but also a very real way through the indwelling and presence of the Holy Spirit? If so, answer, yes, I believe. And is it truly your intention this day that Matthew, Christopher, and Matthias Telby be baptized into the Christian church and faith? If so, answer, yes, it is. And how old is young Matthew?
He'll be 5 months on the 27th.
Okay. Can I hold him for a moment? Yeah, you see that big picture up there? Do you see yourself, Nathan? Do you see yourself up there, Nathan? Huh? Nathan, look here. Who's this? Who's this I'm holding? Matthew, that's right. Little Matthew, for Jesus Christ came, he struggled and he suffered. For you, he endured the darkness of Gethsemane and the agony of Calvary. For you, he cried out, it is finished. For you, he triumphed over death. For you, my little friend, know nothing of all this. But thus is confirmed the word of the apostle, we love because God first loved us. Hold him, bring him near to water in a way it's comfortable for you, and I'll do the rest. Matthew, Christopher, Matthias, Telby, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Matthew, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Hold him just naturally now. And let's have Rex come forward, and let's have you guys read your statement. Great. And then let's have him, Rex, light that, and you can share that, Teresa. Great.
Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify our Father in heaven. Matthew 5:16.
All right. Nathan needs anointed. Yeah. Nathan, I want to warn you, I was like that very much so, any more so, I ended up being a preacher. So, sometimes the only way you can redeem yourself is get ordained. And sometimes, yeah. Now, on the anniversary of this day each year, we'd encourage you to take this candle out of its box, light it, and share with Matthew a spiritual birthday party. So you realize that baptism is not a self-contained event like a ticket into a parking meter to a parking lot. It's not a spiritual vaccination so much as it is an inaugural of a journey that you want God's presence and His Holy Spirit to be with Matthew always. So, Teresa, how about blowing out that candle? Let me have Matthew yet again. Nathan, you want to walk downtown with me here? With your brother? Want to walk with me? Members of Christ Savior Lutheran Church, this is the latest member of the body of Christ in this sector of God's universe. Nathan's bringing me and his younger brother. And so far, he's totally cooperative. Yeah, I know we're leaving your family, Matthew. I'm not too comfortable there, is it? Nathan, let's go down this way, buddy. Come on, come with me. Come on, buddy. Want to tell people who this is? Tell Miss Holtry here who your brother's name is. Tell Miss Holtry here who his name is. His name is Matthew. All right, you want to tell anybody else here? This is a member of the body of Christ writ small, Fishers, Indiana, and a member of the body of Christ writ large across all time, all cultures, all economic strata. This is he's placed within the body of Christ and also in Fishers. Nathan, let's go back this way to Mom and Dad, okay? You're doing great, buddy. You want to be an usher someday? Huh? Come on, this way. Come on back upstairs, buddy. They're fun people to be with. They really are. Why don't you ask somebody to take you out for pizza? Okay, Nathan, be with Mommy and Daddy. Now, the water is already cooling up. Okay. Let's have this prayer here. The prayer itself. Okay. Let's pray, congregation. Lord, we have here in our church family and your Christian community around the world a new child, a new person, a new soul. And the responsibility of this little guy is too much for any two parents alone. They need the loving support of the fellowship of believers here and elsewhere as a training guide and nurture young Matthew. Remind us of our partnership with him and nurturing him toward Christian maturity. As parents, family, friends, and godparents and congregation, may we uphold him with our love, assist in teaching him the word of God, encourage him when he fails, and may we all be careful not to bruise this tender guy unnecessarily by harsh words or too quick of judgments or cruel criticism. And Lord, may a number of us live to see the day when Matthew will choose for himself and know you as Savior and Lord of his life. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. Young Matthew, Christopher, Matthias, Telby, we welcome you to the body of Christ, writ large and small. And congregation, let's welcome him. Oh, yeah. That and that. certificate for the sponsors to sign. And that's it. God bless you. Welcome. Celebration. And now we can take time to greet one another. Get carried away and greet one another. Extend yourself.
Now is it on?
Yeah.
All right. Thanks. I know how to work a microphone. That's some sarcasm. car wash today, and it's an awesome day to get your car washed. Hopefully the car wash will bring in rain the next few days. You know how that works. If you wash your car, then it rains a few days because we kind of need the rain in the area. But you can get your car washed and Thrive It will match funds, and it'll help our students who are going to Puerto Rico. The cost for each student to go to Puerto Rico is $1,200. We're going to a little town called Hormigueros, which we're going to be building wheelchair access ramps, painting homes. It's towards the west coast. It's not in a touristy town. It's in a town that needs attention and some help. And so we're going to go there to serve. So that's what the car wash is about. Have three different locations out in the parking lot to get your car washed. You don't have to wait too long. Also, we have gifts for CTS men right back here on the table, back of the CLC. The CTS Band of Brothers have purchased books as a gift to the dads. And if you know a dad that's not here today, you can go ahead and pick up a book for them. Whatever to encourage our fathers, that's what the desire is today. Also, remember that VBS starts this week, so please return all VBS donations. Each and every pink slip is important. And VBS begins tomorrow at 9 a.m. Thanks.
The first lesson is from Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. Then God said, "Let us make human beings in our image, be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, all the wild animals on the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground." So God created human beings in His own image. In the image of God, He created them. Male and female, He created them. The second lesson is from Psalms chapter 8, verses 1 through 6. O Lord, our Lord, Your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. You have taught children and infants to tell of your strength, silencing your enemies and all who oppose you. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think about them, human beings that you should care for them? Yet You made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with the glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority. The gospel is from St. Matthew, chapter 16, verses 13 through 18. When Jesus arrived in the villages of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "What are people saying about who the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some think he is John the Baptizer, some say Elijah, some Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets." He pressed them, "And how about you? Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter said, "You're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus came back, "God bless you, Simon, son of Jonah. You didn't get that answer out of books or from teachers. My Father in heaven, God himself, let you in on the secret of who I really am. And now I'm going to tell you who you are, really are. You are Peter, the rock. This is the rock on which I will put together my church, a church so expansive with energy that not even the gates of hell will be able to keep it out. Gospel of the Lord.
Congregation, over the next few weeks, beginning today, we're going to give focus sermon series-wise next set of Sundays on what it means to love self. Remember, the banner of emphasis this year is the two great commandments found in the New Testament, as also in the Old Testament for that matter, and that is to love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And so earlier this year, we talked for a few weeks and instructed people about loving God. Now, beginning today, the next few weeks, Beth Borum and I are going to ride tandem with each other, talking about and giving some instruction, hopefully some insights about what it means to love self. And then this fall, what it means to love others. And David and Beth Borum, you know, Beth is our interim associate minister of maturity and ministry. She and her husband, David, are jointly teaching a class started last Wednesday. It continues the next four Wednesdays based upon the text, The Gift of Being Yourself, The Sacred Call to Self-Discovery, written by David Benner. And this book is for purchase in the bookstore as well as for disbursement in the class. Some 50 people were in that class last Wednesday. And if you'd like to get in under the wire and still get in that class, I would suggest you seek out Beth and come next Wednesday with at 7 o'clock. And even if you're not going to be in a class, this is a great summer reading reflective book, The Gift of Being Yourself. Very, very important. Let's pray about this inauguration of this series, please. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for your grace and mercy extended toward us. We thank you for the music we've experienced this morning that's tenderized our hearts and our beings. We thank you for the stability, the trustworthiness, the longevity of your word, of Scripture, of the Holy Spirit, and you, O God, the sovereign God in Jesus Christ, expressed through Scripture. We thank you for the Christian church as expressed in so many ways across the universe. And Lord, we just pray that you would help us take to heart what it means for us to learn to love ourselves these next set of weeks. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. And may the words of my mouth Now, Bill Smith, who read the lessons, I selected these lessons in a real intentional way because the first passage has to do with you and I having significance. And the reason why you and I have significance isn't primarily because we have gifts as persons, skill sets, but because we are made and created in the image of God. That's why you have abiding significance. Because see, if you put in prop your significance and your worth on your job, and then you lose your job, you feel as if you have lost significance. Because instead of using the gifts and skill sets God's given you as an expression of your gratitude for life, you tend, because of you and I having such grave insecurity about our worth, we tend to invest our worth and worthwhileness and well-being in our work. And so this is a great passage, this first one, about being made in the image of God, because it's a way of telling us, because you are made in the image of God, fashioned with some sense of his own character, fashioned with a capacity to create and to destroy, and having a sense of what it means to have a capacity to love and a vulnerability to receive love, these are all sorts of expressions and attributes of a person made in the image of God. And we have problems when we tend to take the things he bequeathed to us by virtue of gifts and skill sets and place our worth there. So I want to share with you, when you're made in the image of God, that means you have abiding significance. And on your bad hair days, when you feel worthless, instead of trying to work harder so you can regain and proptize your sense of significance, instead you need to go into the presence of God, into intimacy with him, and recover a true sense of your abiding significance. We have significance because we're made in the image of God. Now, in the days when this scripture was written, ages after it was true, because the Bible was written ages after the act of creation, but in the days in which this particular scripture in Genesis was written, the culture of the day, the mindset of the popular spread of people, was only the king of the land was made in the image of God. Only the king of the land. Everyone else was in subjection to the only one who was made in the image of God, the ruler. And for the Bible to tell us that we're all made in the image of God, it means by implication we're all royalty. We're all kids of the king. We all have royalty in our blood, and we have abiding significance. And it's hard for us to really let that penetrate us, but that's part of our journey of identity, is to first of all know you have abiding significance as a person. The second passage, the Psalm passage, where it talks about a couple things. It really adores God, and it tells us that we need to approach God with awe and a sense of wonder. But it also tells us, not only like the first passage, that we have significance, it tells us later in that passage of Psalm 8, it tells us that we have a special responsibility. If we indeed are royalty, if we indeed get our cues from God in whose image we're made, then we should steward and express our dominion over life, our families, and our being citizens, and the skill sets that we bring to bear in work and in our neighborhood. We should steward our dominion in such a way that shows that we're not self-centered, but we're expressions of the image of God. People who have abiding significance because they're made in the image of God also have a special responsibility in how they steward their lives. And that passage in Psalms is trying to get that across to us. I mean, the whole idea of who we are is a very interesting one because, you know, I think it's easier for an amoeba and a tulip to be who they are than for you and I to be who we are. A tulip and an amoeba automatically serve God well and are totally in touch with their identity. But our identity is more complicated because we get to make choices. We make decisions. And some of the choices we make and some of the decisions we make, some of them are made by us in such a way it draws us away from our identity rather than moves us in a pathway of cultivating identity. And we've got to be aware of that special responsibility of finding our identity by finding that we cannot really know who we are until we reckon with who God is. And this is very important. In fact, if you could look more closely with me in the third passage, let's look at that for a couple more extra moments, and then I'm going to share with you something on the big screen we've never seen before. And it'll be really a way of delivering what I want to get across to us here in this inauguration of the series of loving self. In the Matthew 16 passage, one of the Gospels, and here we've baptized Matthew, and we're drawn from Matthew. When Jesus arrived in the villages of Caesarea Philippi, now you've got to realize that when he moved into this community, that the influences of Greek and Roman culture were everywhere. We also need to realize that pagan temples and idols abounded. Pagan temples and idols abounded in the culture. And Jesus is 2.5 years into his 3-year trek with the disciples. They've come to know him pretty well. He's come to know them pretty well. And then he puts this question to them. You can see that there? What are people saying about who the Son of Man is? Son of Man is another expression for the Messiah, the Son of God. That's why it's capitalized. Because, see, Jesus is from God, and Jesus is of us. Jesus is divinity and humanity weaved together in a combination that we'll never know before or since. And so he's asking them, have you put your ears to the ground well enough, long enough, to hear from others who people say that I am? So he's really asking what you might call an academic question. Are you a good listener to what the culture around you is saying about me? And so look at that. What they say. They reply. And by the way, when they reply, they're thinking probably about an age-old passage, ages earlier than this, that they knew most of them by heart. Deuteronomy 18:18 says that God would cause a prophet to arise from among his people. And lo and behold, a number of times God did that. God would raise an Isaiah or a Jeremiah or an Elijah or an Obadiah from among the people. to speak truth to them to help them get their heads and sights going the right way. So hence we see there in verse 14, they reply, some think he's John the Baptist, baptizer, some say Elijah, some Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets. Because God promised he would raise among the people one prophet. And now here's Jesus, a very prophetic person. That's who you are. That's who they say you are. And he presses them. This is very important because some things we need to get an answer to don't come natural to us. We need pressed. We need to give more thought. We need to kind of not entertain, but dwell in the journey of trying to discover what an answer is to a question. Jesus presses them. And how about you? Who do you say that I am? You see what's happening there? At that point, Jesus is moving from the academic question of simply being a good listener to a deeply personal question. A question that's singly each person's answer. I can't answer for you. You can't answer for me. The fact of the matter is, the first question he asks is the word what. The second question he asks is the word who. What do people say that I am about? But the next one is that who do you say that I am? A deeply personal question, no longer academic. And what happens here? There are 12 who've known him for two and a half years. And it says there in verse 16, Simon Peter says, you're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of a living God. Jesus comes back. You see it there with me? God bless you. Indeed, that's how he got it. God bless you, Simon, son of Jonah. You didn't get that answer out of books or from teachers. In other words, it didn't come to you secondhand. This is an experience as you unfold your life with me. You're experiencing a sense of who I am, a revelation from God. My Father in heaven, God himself, let you in on this secret of who I really am. And now I'm going to tell you who you really are. Now, Peter knew he was a fisherman. He knew he was the son of Jonah. He knew he was a disciple of Jesus. But Jesus says he was in store for a lot more about his true identity than simply his job title or simply being from a family line. And this is true of you, too. You have a family line. You can name your forebears. You have a job title, you know what it's involved, and all the loving and gory details of it. But it doesn't completely or even at a core define you. But here's the catch. This is why this passage is so important. Peter had a sense of who he was and could answer very ably. But at the point at which he, through God's special gift of revelation, which God grants us through the Holy Spirit in us, through that special sense of revelation, Peter came to know that Jesus was more than just one of the prophets. He was the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the Son of God. God revealed that to him. Here's the catch in this. When Peter said by revelation of God that Jesus was the Son of God and the Savior of the world, Jesus then says, God himself and your experience of God in your life revealed this to you. And now that you have told me who I am, how did Jesus put it there, congregation? Let's look at it very closely so you know I'm not leprechaun teasing you. He says, you didn't get the answer out of the books of the teachers. My Father in heaven, God himself, let you in on this secret of who I really am. And now I'm going to tell you who you really, really are. You are Peter, a rock. Now listen. When Peter discovered who Jesus was in his own experience of life, when he was able to say who Jesus really was, Son of the living God, the Messiah, when that confession of faith happened, his fuller sense of his identity was born, and the pathway of fuller understanding of that identity continued until he died. So here's the catch. If you think you know who you are, you're in store for a lot more information on an interpersonal level than you can ever imagine. Because once you tell Jesus who he is, and you're on target saying who he is, Jesus in turn tells you who you are. You cannot know who you are as a person. It'll always be fuzzy until you know God through Christ. When you know God through Christ, that fuzziness gets clearer, it gets more and more put to the wayside, and the clarity of understanding of who you are is going on moment by moment, day by day, decade by decade. But you can't know who you are apart from who he is. When you declare who Jesus is, he gives you a gift of identity back and tells you who you are the rest of your days, if you stay with it, if you stay with it. But here's the problem, my friends. We are gravely insecure as people. And a lot of what God gifts us with becomes the centerfold of our life. And we let that define us. And you know what? The roof's going to cave in and the bottom's going to give out when we let the gifts God's given us be our chief points of true identity. And this is illustrated in this video that we're going to watch.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the old familiar sting. Try to kill it all away, but I remember everything. What have I become? My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt. I will let you down, I will make you hurt.
You stay the hell away from me, you hear?
I wear this crown of thorns upon my liar's chair, full of broken thoughts I cannot repair. Beneath the stains of time, the feelings disappear. You are someone else, I am still right here. What have I become? My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt. I will let you down, I will make you hurt. If I could start again a million miles away, I would keep myself, I would find a way.
Nothing beats a living testimony of a person who's really had it all in many ways in terms of fame and fortune. A decade ago or so or more, when he was still riding high on the popularity ratings of his music, he said he went underneath a bridge. He wanted to give up his life. And at that point, somehow God visited him, got his attention, and what was left of his life, where he was emotionally and spiritually bankrupt, what little he had left, he yielded over to God, and God reconstructed his life into a testimony. And this tune, Hurt, was written really by one of the guys in the Nine Inch Nails group, and he gave blessing to Johnny to change some of the lyrics. And Johnny Cash is a great testimony of a person who let the gifts be the identity definers. And what he found, it left him empty. And the whole crown of thorns thing is a very intriguing one. I want to share this with your congregation. This is very important. Many years ago, when I was an infant, and I was baptized in the Catholic Church in Columbus, Ohio, a folk hero on my mom's own side of the family, named Paul Shea, was my godparent in my baptism. His favorite song was I Walk the Line. He sang it, but he didn't live it. And also, at age 40, he could strip a basket mid-court. The tallest in the family, fine basketball person in high school, and a wife with children. But he just didn't like that whole thing about the gig, about being with the family. And so he robbed banks, he did all kinds of things, and years into it, finally the law caught up with him, caught him in California, and sentenced him to San Quentin. And my uncle Paul Shea, the godparent at my baptism, a few years into his time in a cell by himself in San Quentin, a man so wild in his body that his whole spirit couldn't keep up. His body couldn't keep up with his spirit and drive to make a quick buck in all kinds of illegal ways. And he ended up dying in the cell by himself. And I want to tell you something. Because he was my godparent, because he was so much fun in my mom's side of the family and we enjoyed him, I want to tell you something. I feel cheated. I feel personally cheated to this day because I will never know the Paul Shea that he was supposed to be. He became another kind of person. He made certain kinds of choices which got him further and further away from the core of what he could have become. He had gifts that could have led him that way. And you know what? Here's the thing about missing your identity pathway and simply having the appearance of an identity. Get this. When you don't reckon with who God is, when you don't really yield your heart and life to God through Jesus Christ, your idea of your identity will be mostly fuzzy, and you'll miss the point, and you can live 70 or 80 years. Now, here's the catch. Will you walk a pathway being aware of God and His love and grace in such a way that you will reckon with your identity development? And I want to share with you something very special here. See, I think we all know that God is a mysterious being. And I want to thank Carrie Jarrett for loaning that DVD to me and making it possible for me to borrow it and listen to it again and again. But I want to share with you, I think the Lord understands the spirit in which I'm saying this. I think God would have cheated you and me if He would have remained mostly a mystery and didn't reveal Himself more in a more disclosing way through the person of Christ. He would have cheated the world, given how humanity is. God would have cheated the world, including you and me, if He hadn't disclosed more fully who He is through Jesus Christ. But you know what? When God decided, given our humanity, that He needed to disclose Himself more fully and even save us from our sins, and did so through the life of His Son, when God did that, that kind of self-disclosed identity cost Him a great deal. It cost Him the life of His Son. There's no parent here, when your kid hurts, you don't hurt with them, by definition of who you are as a parent. So when you disclose who you are as a person, that is, when you go through that journey inward, beyond your gifts and skills and marketability, when you take that inward journey, you're going to be disclosing yourself to yourself. And it's going to be painful. That kind of disclosure is going to be downright agonizing. But if you look at the lyrics, show the lyrics there for a moment. The lyrics to the tune. He says, I hurt myself a day to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. You know what he's saying there? He's discovered years since that the closest way for him to experience true identity is to take the inward journey and face the pain, no longer to avoid it. Strangely enough, you come closest to who you are when you take the inward journey and see the pain. Let's go on. The old familiar sting, try to kill it all away, but I remember everything. What have I become? Now, here's the catch here. Try to kill it away, what? Through drugs and alcohol. You could kill it away through workaholism and get paid well. But when you do that alcoholism stuff or the drug stuff or you do the workaholism stuff, whatever your addiction is, the fact of the matter is when you wake up from it in cold sobriety, you remember everything. And then you ask the question, what have I become? It's curious, not who have I become? Because there's only one who you can become. It's what have I become? Just like Jesus says, what do they say who I am? What do they say about me? Versus who do you say that I am? That's a very curious word, what have I become? Because there's only one who you can become. Let's go on. My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end. Now get this, my sweetest friend is really his own true self beckoning him to be. If you look at the lyrics as a whole at one time, the sweetest friend has to do with he himself calling himself into true identity. Everyone I know goes away in the end. People either die before he dies, there's a picture of his mother on the wall, or people abandon him because they're tired of his stuff. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt. Now, he did a lot to build it up. You saw that one award-winning record on the floor against the wall with the glaring window of glass broken. Thanks. Just testing you out there. And you could have it all, what, my empire of dirt. He thought he was building an empire, but he discovered with closer scrutiny, because he traded on his identity in a bad, adverse way, it was dirt. Go on, please. I will let you down or will make you hurt. Now, what's that saying? Our rendering of loving people is never going to be perfect. By definition, we're going to hurt people. And by definition, people who love us are going to hurt us. And you know what? We will let each other down. There's only one person who can be present to us in such a way that he will not let us down. We may interpret that for a moment of bad-heartedness, but he will not let us down. In fact, to learn to not let people down as much as we do, we need his presence in our hearts and lives in order to have the sufficiency of strength that we don't have native to ourselves to let people down less. Let's go on. I wear this crown of thorns upon my liar's chair. Liar's chair means he lost his integrity. The crown of thorns means a sense of suffering. Full of broken thoughts I cannot repair. We all have regrets. We can't change them or repair them. Let's go on. Beneath the stains of time, the fillings disappear. You are someone else. I am still right here. Now, here it is. His true identity is still right there. If he could just move toward it and embrace it. My friend, it's the inward journey. It's taking Christ with you. It's saying, help me face who I am so I can become who you want me to be. My true identity. Let's move on. What have I become? My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end, and you could have it all, my empire dirt. Go on. I will let you down. I will make you hurt. And then the last stanza. Go for that. I think it's the last stanza. Yeah. If I could start again a million miles away, I would keep myself, I would find a way. Now here's the catch. He wants to rebuild integrity in the days that remain for him. He wants to find out who he really is. And you know what? Johnny Cash has spoken at Billy Graham Crusades to speak to that. To speak to that. So, let me share this. In a way of closing, your identity is not so much an achievement as it is a gift. It comes from your being made in His image. It comes from you having a special responsibility. Your identity is not an achievement, it's a gift. Also, your identity is not so much your creation as it is your discovery. Do you still want to discover who you are instead of trying to create who you think you are? Johnny Cash, a king who crashed and then experienced the king And it was that king he discovered, like Peter discovered, who helped him discover and become a certain gift of identity that Johnny Cash would tell you he would never know otherwise. I want to close with a true story, since this is Father's Day. There's a seminary professor who, with his wife, took a holiday from the seminary he was a seminary professor of in Oklahoma. And they decided to go to Gatlinburg, Tennessee for a few days. And they were eating breakfast in a little restaurant, hoping to enjoy a quiet couple meal. And while they were waiting for their food, they noticed a distinguished-looking, gray-haired man moving from table to table, visiting with the guests in that restaurant. And the professor leaned over and whispered to his wife, "I hope he doesn't come over here." But sure enough, that man did come over to the table. "Where are you folks from?" he asked in a friendly voice. "Oklahoma," they answered. "Great to have you here in Tennessee. What do you do for a living?" "I teach at the seminary," he replied. "Oh, so you teach preachers how to preach, do you? Well, I've got a really great story for you," and guess what he did? He invited himself to the table and pulled up a chair to share the story. And the professor groaned and thought to himself, "Great, just what I need, another preacher story." And the man starts, "See that mountain through the window? Not far from the base of that mountain, there was a boy born to an unwed mother. And he had a hard time growing up because every place he went, he was always asked the same question, 'Hey boy, who's your daddy?' And whether he was at school, in the grocery store, drugstore, people would ask the same question invariably, 'Who's your daddy?' And so he often would hide at recess and lunchtime or at the grocery store from other students and people. He would avoid people in every way he could when he sensed that question was about to be asked. And when he was about 12 years old, the local church had a new preacher, a new pastor. And the boy would always go in late and slip out early to avoid hearing the question, "Who's your daddy?" Not because he was a Catholic. He didn't go in late and come in. Lutherans were practicing that more and more now. But one day, the new preacher said the benediction so fast, the boy got caught and had to walk out with the crowd. And just about that time, he got to the back door. The new preacher, not knowing anything about the boy, put his hand on the boy's shoulder and asked him, "Son, who's your daddy?" And the whole church grew deathly quiet. He could feel every eye in the church looking at him, and now everyone would finally know the answer to the question, "Who's your daddy?" This new preacher, though, he sensed the situation around him, and using discernment from the Holy Spirit in his own life, he said the following to that scared little boy, "Wait a minute, I know who you are. I see the family resemblance now. You're a child of God." And with that, the boy smiled. And he felt his spirit was buoyed up. And he began to think differently of himself from that point on as he met with the preacher. And whenever anybody would ask him, "Who's your daddy?" he'd just say, "I'm a child of God." And the distinguished gentleman got up from the table and said, "Isn't that a great story?" And the professor responded with a surprise that it really was a great story. And he could use it. And as the gray-haired man turned to leave, before he totally left that table, he said, "You know, if that new preacher hadn't told me that I was one of God's children, I probably would never amounted to anything." And he walked away. And the seminary professor and his wife were stunned, and they called the waitress over and asked her, "Do you know who that man was who just left that was sitting at our table?" The waitress grinned and said, "Of course. Everybody here knows him. That's Ben Hooper, the former governor of Tennessee." Here's the moral in the story. First of all, you need to know that you're a child of God, that you have abiding significance, a special responsibility, and you'll never get beyond the point of entry of who you are until you know God through Jesus Christ. And you need to help people to awaken in the midst of all the props we build to secure against our insecurity about who we are.